You ever notice that sometimes theme parks have buildings that are just giant things? A big traffic cone that sells food. A camera shop with a giant camera on the front. A hat shop in the shape of a hat. And an ice cream stand inside of a big dinosaur. It's a style called programmatic architecture. And today we're going to talk about where it came from, why it exists, and why you can find it in very specific parts of theme parks. The term programmatic architecture is relatively new, as it was just coined a little over 40 years ago by historian David Gebert. The general definition is that it's architecture that, quote, uses the mimetic sculptural form of the structure to communicate its contents. So taken literally, a big hat with a hat store inside, or a big cone that sells cones, or a giant dinosaur that sells ice cream. Okay, so that last one doesn't really work in the literal sense, which is why it might be more fitting to call it by its other common name, novelty architecture. While the name is new, the style itself dates back hundreds of years to a 17th century park in Italy called the Sacred Grove of Bomarzo. It was owned by a Count Orsini, who sounds like a magician, but was really just a rich patron of the arts. The garden has these large stone sculptures of dragons and elephants and sirens, but most importantly, a giant head that doubled as a dining pavilion. The following century saw another prominent example with a giant pineapple that sat atop the Dunmore House in Scotland. As the story goes, it was common for sailors returning from long passages to set a pineapple on a gatepost to signal their return. Pineapples were rare and expensive, and they served as proof that they were coming from afar. In 1776, the owner of the Dunmore House, John Murray, was returning from America. He was the governor of the colony of Virginia for Great Britain. But as it turned out, in 1775, the colonies decided to start, let's just say, phasing out British rule. So Murray, preferring to stay alive, which I can't blame him for, returned home, and in an interesting turn, decided to place the biggest pineapple he could on top of his house. In other words, early programmatic architecture was a product of wealthy flourishes and eccentricities. They didn't really serve a purpose beyond being creative and showing off how much money somebody had. That would change by the end of the 1800s, however. Many experts claim that the first example of programmatic architecture's new era, specifically in the United States, occurred in 1881. When a man by the name of James Lafferty built a giant elephant house in Margate, New Jersey. The elephant would be named Lucy. I actually have a whole other video about Lucy if you'd like to learn more, but the short take is that Lucy was built by Lafferty in order to lure over tourists from Atlantic City and to act as a viewing platform for all of the surrounding real estate he was trying to sell. It was novelty architecture directly tied to a business venture. Of course, it was still weird and eccentric, but it finally had a purpose. Novelty architecture began to grow in the United States, but it would be the 1920s and 30s when it would really start to hit its stride. And it was thanks to two shifts in American culture that happened at the same time. During the 1920s, American car ownership more than tripled, from 6.7 million cars to 23 million cars. And a lot of those new automobile owners were part of the middle class as cars grew more affordable. At the same time, the 1920s was the decade in which America finally began to more widely adopt the concept of a five-day work week. Together, this meant that more and more Americans had free time to kill on the weekends, and more Americans had the means to travel to do so. The result was a new demand for amusements and attractions out on the open road. It also meant appealing to a new kind of consumer. These businesses no longer had to worry about winning over the attention of a pedestrian walking down the block, but instead a motorist driving along a road. That meant designing buildings that were big and bold and eye-catching, even if it bordered on silly and novel. Los Angeles, for some reason, became one of the leading areas of programmatic architecture. Some suggest it was Hollywood and the locals' embrace of the fantastic, and others theorize that it was just the abundance of set designers in the city. Some even suggest that because LA was more spread out and relatively younger than cities on the East Coast, they had space to play around with the concepts. Regardless of the reason, places like the Brown Derby restaurant on Wilshire Boulevard and the Darkroom Camera Shop, also on Wilshire, began to spring up. Donuts, pianos, frogs, pigs, even shoes found a home in Southern California. it became so prominent there that the style eventually picked up another name, California Crazy. And ultimately, that's one of the bigger reasons why you can find programmatic architecture in certain theme parks today. Gertie at Hollywood Studios, the Dark Room at both Disney World and Universal Studios, and Universal's Brown Derby all call back to an era in California's history that their parks are trying to mimic. Even places like the Cozy Cone in DCA's Radiator Springs, while fictional, still aims to capture that roadside atmosphere of a bygone era. Of course, beyond that, the resorts have embraced the same benefits that the original architecture offered 100 years ago. And so you can also find more original uses of the style at some resorts and parks. Over the years, the concept spread to roadside attractions across the country. But as the nation's interstate highway system started to take form, getting from A to B with as few stops as possible became easier. And as a result, these roadside attractions fell on hard times. On top of that, like pretty much all architectural styles, it eventually fell out of favor with people. Of course, it didn't disappear completely, but its time in the spotlight had come to a close. Programmatic architecture is interesting, because while it wasn't born here in America, it eventually became embraced by the US to the point that it's often seen as a distinctly American style. It became a part of early Hollywood's DNA. So much so that when theme parks decided to eventually mimic the era, they couldn't help but include the buildings themselves. I guess in a way, making them part of the park's DNA as well. Thank you.